Seen enough?
Is going to press for the highest levels of compensation for the families of those who so tragically lost their lives.
Everyone shouts at once. We won't hear what the Deputy Prime Minister has to say.
When 19 people were killed and 94 injured in an explosion at the nearby Petrofex refinery 3 days.
I want to reassure you that we will leave no stone unturned. A team from the HSE are already at work, and the Petrofex company is sending specialists from the United States to back them up.
It remains to be seen who will win the election, but the government I represent, we will rebuild here in Scarra. You have my word.
Your word's worth nothing. You lot have got it.
I think we should all please calm down. Let him go, Sergeant.
Mr. Dawkins, have you heard of Solendale?
I'm sorry?
Have you heard of Solendale? The man beside you might have.
Yeah, it's one of our plants in the US.
4 years ago, they came very close to having an incident just like the one they've had here.
My word, it's all.
If I could just interject.
The company commissioned a confidential report and made changes to safety procedure at Solendale, procedure that was not implemented here at Scarrow.
Mr. Dawkins, would you like to read that report? I've got a copy here.
Just a journalist out to cause trouble.
No, sir. I thought we were going to get lynched in there.
People are angry. It's understandable.
They don't get it, do they? It's all us. This, you know. The minibuses, after school, club, maintenance of the hall. It's all Petrofex money.
Are you saying they're ungrateful?
No.
Of a thankless task.
Being Deputy Prime Minister is a succession of thankless tasks.
Interesting.
Sobering.
I have met with criticism for attending the summit here in the US at such a sensitive time. However, the opportunity to press the case of the people of Scarrow with Paul Clark and the others at Petrofex, who will ultimately be making the decisions regarding their future, was one I felt that I had to grasp. We value the jobs that this company brings to an area of considerable economic deprivation, but we also demand the very highest possible safety standards. It is these issues that I have raised with Mr. Clark, who is as concerned as we are for the people of Scarrow.
You know, I know Teesside well. I know the calibre of the people there. And I know that after a period of recovery, a period of mourning, grieving their losses from this awful tragedy, that those communities will recover. Make no mistake.
It's in Section 4.
Yes. Thanks to Ellis Kane's helpful post-its. Yes, I've seen Section 4.
Ellis Kane, freelance journalist. The Americans want to tap her phone.
The Americans do, right. The Americans at MI5 or the Americans at MI6? Trigger word?
Petrifax.
Thank you. Deputy Prime Minister. It's good of you to come.
Thank you. She was what age?
2½.
Strangely peaceful in here.
It is now.
The leader of the opposition, Carol Malloy, claimed today that the Prime Minister's continued absence from the UK at a time of national tragedy serves to underline that the government is out of touch with the people it is supposed to serve. The latest poll figures add weight to her argument. The government is now lagging on average 9 points behind the opposition.
Prime Minister.
Hello, Charles.
Tom.
Still up in the air?
Just about.
It's a little rough up here, but we're almost through it now. Listen, change of plan. I'm flying straight to Teesside. I'll be there in about 3 hours.
I want you to go to number 10 in any case. Hold the fort until I get there.
We're on our way.
Listen, Charles. Did you know there was a similar incident at Solondale 4 years ago?
Solondale isn't relevant, Tom.
What's important
is that I've got Clark's word on a very hefty package of compensation and reconstruction.
And you have his signature on that, I presume?
Listen, I know that you think
that this trip to the US was a waste of time.
I think we're losing the election, Charles. Not many votes in Texas.
So the
compensation package that
covers everything,
chapter and verse.
Hello? Charles?
Lost him?
Call him back, will you?
Laura Duchesne.
Mom?
Is Charles Flight going to resign?
All radio and radar contact has been lost with the plane carrying the Prime Minister back from the United States.
The last contact was made when the plane was approximately 900 miles west of the British Isles over the Atlantic. Its scheduled arrival time was 1:30 this afternoon, 3 hours ago. There were no distress signals, nor have there been any warnings or claims of responsibility. The circumstances are grave, but there remains a possibility that the Prime Minister and the plane's other passengers
are alive. That's all I wish to say.
Where was the plane last year? Who's running
the country, Mr. Dawkins?
What the fuck's happened to Charles, Tom?
Wish I knew.
Well, you did well. A military background like yours comes in handy at times like this, I suppose.
Gents.
That's what it says on the door, Ross.
Wouldn't want to be missing anything.
Well, first off, thanks to Tom Dawkins for fronting up so effectively while ministers were dashing back from far-flung parts. Now, as Deputy Prime Minister, Tom is well placed to bring continuity while the dust settles. Yeah. I'd like to suggest he base himself here for the time being. And now I'll pass over to Laura Duchene for the security position.
Thank you. All we're looking at, thank you, is scenarios. The more obvious terrorist angles, Al-Qaeda, dissident Irish Republicans, some sort of double-header with the Scarrow explosion.
But there wasn't a bomb at Scarrow.
We can't be certain yet, but we don't think so. However, it was an unscheduled flight, and the fact that so few...
Whose plane was here?
It was a Petrofex plane. As I say, the fact that so few people knew the PM was returning that way renders an attack less likely. But don't rule it out.
We still don't know if there was an incident. I think he's going to be all right.
Do you really think he's still flying around up there, Felix?
I wish he was. Which is more than could be said for you, Roz.
Details remain thin on the ground in the wake of the disappearance of the plane carrying the Prime Minister.
Toothpaste, toothbrush, flannel, towel, soap.
Oh, thank you. And earplugs?
In the drawer beside the bed.
Thank you. The Deputy Prime
Minister, Tom Dawkins... Shall I close the curtains?
No, thank you. It's okay.
I've been praying for him. I'm going to pray for you too.
To wake you so early.
We've had a call. They've found wreckage.
He's dead. Nothing we do is going to change that. We'd have had to replace him after he lost us the election anyhow.
I need to know what my approval numbers are. Exactly. So who else is saying yes?
I've got a lot of support. I'll have a hell of a lot more if I can say that Tom Dawkins will be my DPM.
Ross, Felix, we need a show of solidarity.
Coronation. Couldn't agree more.
Just need a credible coronee.
Now, you two will have to wrestle with that. I suggest that as a neutral, Tom hangs on to the reins. In the meantime.
I know what you're doing, John.
There's a party to lead and a country to run, and when it comes right down to it, it's me or Fauntleroy. Think about it, a country run by Felix.
Ross, this isn't the time.
I'm offering you the deputyship. Do we have a deal?
Do I have a choice?
Good luck.
It is with great sadness that I have to inform you that wreckage retrieved from the North Atlantic early this morning has now been identified as coming from the plane carrying our nation's Prime Minister. The government is therefore regretfully adopting an official position. The Prime Minister is dead. A memorial service will be held within the next week, and the party will choose a new leader to take us into the election. I hope I speak for all of us when I say that, as a man and a leader, he will be greatly missed. Coming as this does, tragically, this comes in the wake of the disaster in Scarrow. And on the back of a good few years now of real hardship for a lot of people in this country. And you might feel, as I do, that our nation is being sorely tested. It is. It is. But a tragedy like this can act to bring us together despite political differences and economic strife. I have a powerful belief that all those who live in this great nation of ours can play a part as we pick our way through our current troubles, and that even in the midst of tragedy, we must have faith that there is a better path ahead. Charles Flight may be dead, but that idea of faith and hope must endure. Our thoughts are with his wife and with his family. Thank you.
Well done.
The search is intensifying, not for survivors now, but for the flight recorder. Specialists from the US Navy are here, and they're determined to discover whether foul play or mechanical failure lies at the roots of this tragedy.
Charles Flight's reputation as a breath of fresh air in the stale arena of British politics may have been in doubt in the months before his death.
Getting out of the car, John Hodder, appointed chief whip by Charles Flight, and continues to hold great sway within the government.
Arriving with the chief whip, the Foreign Secretary, Ros Yeland, not always the most on message.
The unmistakable figure of the Home Secretary, Felix Durrell, perhaps Charles Flight's closest friend.
And here comes Tom Dawkins, not thought to have been personally close to the Prime Minister, but Charles Flight appreciated his gravitas and experience, appointing him as his deputy despite opposition.
Nothing to report on the investigation?
No black box, no story.
What do you make of the fact that it's a company plane?
You're asking if I subscribe to hysterical conspiracy theories? A member of the Prime Minister's team made a call before they flew that may have been compromising.
To the Taliban?
To a cousin in Luton.
Saeed Khan? You suspect Charles' secretary. Why? Well, because he's Asian. And Saeed can't confirm or deny it because he's been lost with the rest of them.
Isn't that your ex-wife?
Hello, Rosie. How are you?
Fine.
How's Alex and the kids?
You always ask that, Tom. But you never really want to know.
I'm so sorry about Charles.
Thank you. Mr. Dawkins. Mr. Dawkins.
Your boss got nothing out of that meeting with Petrofex. I've seen the minutes.
You've got my number.
Get hold of her file.
Bless you, sir.
Taking time out of your busy schedule to meet me. I'm honored.
Thanks. So, Miss Kane.
Look sharp. That's what he calls himself. It's how he starts his emails. Look sharp. My inside man at Petrofex.
And he has the minutes of the meetings between Charles and
Paul Clark.
And passed them on to me. And in return?
You have a man inside number 10. What more do you want?
I don't know if you read the papers, but your lot are not going to be in number 10 for much longer.
So why give them to me?
I could write the story. I probably will. But right now, you could actually do something.
Pass him over to me.
Yes, ma'am. Sir, Duchenne.
Hello?
Tom, will you please, for Christ's sake, get off the street?
Keeping tabs on me, Laura?
For your information, Saeed Khan's poor, maligned cousin from Luton. He'd been downloading structural diagrams of the plane Charles was killed in.
Sorry about Charles. He was a good man.
He had a great future ahead of him. I was very fond of him.
Yes, I'm sure you were fond of him.
Look, I've just been going through the minutes of your meeting together.
What minutes?
Well, one of Charles's assistants emailed them through before they left.
Charles's assistants weren't in the meeting, Tom.
Well, the point is, I spoke to Charles when he was halfway back.
And what he told me, and the minutes don't, is that you and he agreed on a hefty compensation package for Scarab.
We know what our responsibilities are, Tom.
With all due respect, that's not the impression you're giving.
We need you over here. We need you looking at the devastation on Teesside and telling us what you're going to do about it.
I've seen devastation before, Tom. I saw the place before we set up there.
I see that you're quoted in the press as
saying that an American life is more valuable than a British one.
It's not a moral statement, that's an actuarial one.
Yes, but you set your safety standards accordingly.
I've seen the Solondale report.
Why don't we just row back a little bit here?
Well, why don't we row back to where you deliver what you promised?
You know, I think I'll wait till after the election. I wouldn't want to be wasting my breath.
Is it, John?
Between you and me and the gatepost, I've had a little private poll conducted.
Oh, yes?
And when asked who they would like to see as Prime Minister, given the choice of you, Ross Yelland, or Felix...
They said Wayne Rooney.
56% of them said you. You give off stability, Tom. People are craving that.
No. Rosie Elland is the best man for the job.
Well, the public don't agree. She's not simpatico. Do you really want to be in opposition for the next 5 years?
I'm not a leader.
You look very like one making that speech the other day. You were a captain in the army for 10 years.
That's where I learned my lesson.
Then you're a different man now. And you know it. Now look me in the eye and tell me it isn't true.
She wants me to be her deputy.
God. Tom, we need someone with balls. As DPM to Ross Yelland, you're like the Sultan's fucking eunuch. Come on.
In the press room half a dozen times to try and reach you.
Dr. Ashcroft, briefly, please.
Nyssa Matthews, the little girl whose hand you found, there are toxicity readings in her soft tissue that I wouldn't expect to find. Her and all of the blast victims.
What sort of toxicity readings?
The father's the same, but much more pronounced. He's awash with it. I want to make sure that it's not a genetic anomaly, so I need to keep hold of both of their bodies.
Surely by now you must have completed your investigation.
Her dad, Dermot Matthews, worked at the plant. So I've been asking what he might have come into contact with. The company have been fighting me every inch of the way. They even tried to deny that the body was his at first. Said he wasn't on site at the time. The mother's told the press that I'm keeping the bodies for no reason. I'm under siege just because I'm trying to do my job.
Dr. Ashcroft, we're talking about a woman who's lost her husband and her daughter. Mrs. Matthews just wants the bodies of her loved ones back.
And she will get them. Just as soon as Petrofex give me the information that I need to complete the post-mortems.
Yes. Well, thank you for calling, Doctor.
Hello? Who is this? Who is this?
Bless my soul, it's the father of the nation. Oh. Well, very statesmanlike.
Tony Fawcett.
Him?
Yes.
And, her?
Yes.
And him?
No.
You just haven't met him yet. As you were.
All right. Stand there.
You never lose it.
So how are you, Tony?
Could you actually, could you lend me 20? I've got a cabbie waiting outside.
Taxi's got an oily chain, has it?
I've been to see my sister. You remember her? You shagged her once.
Me? I was blameless. I took the sofa because she wanted the spare room.
Yeah, and why were you on my sofa?
You know bloody well why I was on the sofa.
You compounded your misdemeanor on my sofa with my sister. Now look at you. I miss those days.
Pass me your phone, will you?
Do you mind if I take the battery out? You can never be too careful.
Nobody's bugging me, Tony.
Maybe. As long as you have a battery in your phone, they can drop in whenever they like.
Humor him. We do.
I need your help, Tony. I'm getting nothing from Laura Duchene. No help with Petrifex.
The mighty Laura Duchene was a loaded reports officer when I was at MI5. She always did have her own agenda. And now she's running the place. She could never live with the idea that I knew she'd cocked up on Nightlight.
I had a call from the pathologist. There are toxins at Scarrow that he can't explain. And now Petrifex are obstructing his investigation. So I need to know what they're hiding.
Charles told me that they were going to pay out big compensation. They've gone very quiet on that front.
Have to show them what you're made of, Tom.
Cover the road.
They're telling me I'll have to quit if I become PM. You won't have time to smoke when you're PM. See, the ridiculous thing is, having to do all this without looking like we're actually trying. There's a sense of it being unseemly with Charles, sort of, out there. Look, I know Roz has you on an exclusive, Tom, but it's a lost cause, believe me. Say the word and I'll wrap you in my warm and tender love. Foreign Secretary? That'll give us something to think about on the back benches. You can hide in here for 5 minutes. Clark's been trying to wriggle out of the compensation package that he agreed with Charles.
You haven't been frightening the horses, have you, Tom?
Clark's a slippery sod.
Yes, but don't worry about Clark. We have mutual friends. I've heard that you've been putting it about that they killed Charles. Petrifex.
You heard wrong.
Because you're aware how flaky that would sound in a public arena. You're swimming against the tide, Tom. The company's share price actually rose today.
And who's the company's biggest shareholder, Felix?
Royal Caledonian Bank.
Royal Caledonian Bank. And who owns the bank?
Oh, Tom, look.
We do. The British government, the British people. And the bank owns Petrifex.
You trying to write my manifesto for me?
I just want to know that you'll be on the case, Felix, if we win the election with you as leader.
He's a mix of Mank and Mackem. Formative years in Didsbury, then a good 20-odd in Sunderland.
I have nothing to say to you, all right?
I have nothing to say to you, all right?
This is Dr. Ashcroft, pathologist. I'm not at my desk. I need the test results again for the Matthews family.
How's that, Nightlight? Good. Where's the phone?
What were you doing in Fauntleroy's camp, Tom? Not putting out for favours, I hope.
Oh, just keeping abreast of developments.
What's the latest? Tax relief on gun dogs?
You're not going to beat him, Roz.
Tom, if you're saying you're standing, I'll break your fucking nose. We were a team. I asked if you were standing. You said no. I said come with me.
Look at the polls, Roz.
Fuck the polls. I haven't even started.
And you'd better not get in my way, Tom.
Hello, Colton Laboratory.
This is Dr. Ashcroft, pathology. I'm not at my desk. I need the test results again for the Matthews family.
About your request for promotion. I've been told to tell you not to hold your breath.
There's a surprise.
Economic climate, etc., etc. Hey, want to see something above your pay grade? Have you heard of Saeed Khan? There we go.
What's this?
Photos we intercepted from his phone. The last photos of the PM alive. Sent by Saeed to his cousin before they took off. The same cousin who's just been arrested.
Hello?
Can you put me through to Tom Dawkins, please?
I'm sorry, the Deputy Prime Minister's not available.
And you are who?
I'm Mr. Dawkins' private secretary.
So he's got time to tell you to tell me he hasn't got time to talk to me, but not enough time to tell me that himself. You know he won't shag my sister.
No, I didn't know that, sir. Shall I,
Not many people do. He wasn't always the paragon of virtue he is now. Ask his ex-wife.
She knows where all the bodies are buried.
Nice talking to you, Mr. Fawcett. Is there anything you'd like me to pass on?
Could you tell him to please go fuck himself with a feather duster?
Right. Goodbye, Mr. Fawcett.
Tell him to call.
Tell him he needs to hear more about toxicology.
Police are investigating the death of Scarrow pathologist Mark Ashcroft, whose body was found this evening. Meanwhile, the survivors of Scarrow say the government has abandoned them. Work has yet to resume at the refinery, and no government minister has visited the town since Tom.
Thinking about Bosnia?
Yes.
Tom. You did the right thing.
Did I? If I stand.
Don't, Tom.
Westminster is alive with speculation today as the government decides on a new leader to take them forward into the general election.